So, thank you so much for coming tonight. Before we begin talking about myth in the modern world, I'd like to thank, first of all, Clatsop Community College. They always dedicate their fine material here. Speakers and the projector and everything. It's the microphone. It's really nice. It's very helpful. It's part of the whole spirit of this place. I'd also, even more, like to thank the Fort, Fort George. It is a special thing and a special place that is an actual public house where we can do things like this, have conversations like this, and things like this. It's a good thing. So thank you. So, myth in the modern world. Well, you know, it's funny. When I give these talks, one of the things I try to do when we have a philosophical question like this is I go to different people that I know and I try to ask them the question. So, is there a place for myth in the modern world? And of everybody I asked, I got a resounding yes. Some people with exclamation points. They didn't actually say exclamation points, but it amounted to that. They were really, yes, absolutely. So there's a place for myth in the modern world. But then I asked them, so what is this place? What shall we say this place is? And that's where it starts getting a little bit tricky. Often people spoke about this place as being, well, myth has a place in modern life because it provides a venue for imagination. It's an outlet for imagination. This is something that we have dreams, we have fantasies, this is the way our minds work, it's entertaining, it's important, and mythology gives us a outlet for that. But if you think about what that means, it means that mythology has a place in the modern world because it serves something other than mythology. In other words, mythology is just an instrument. It's not really an answer. I mean, it's not a bad thing, but it's not really an answer. Even more interesting, I thought, was when I asked people, so what is this place? And they tried to begin to answer it, and they tried to begin to talk about it. And they ended up saying, well, I don't really know what this place is. I more wish it had a place, a kind of longing for a place of mythology, right? A longing for there to be some way in which mythology could have a place, make a difference, be somewhere in there. And when I asked them why, they didn't always know. They just said, it seems like it would make things more important, more deep, more rich, more beautiful, something. I don't know. You know, it's the reason I like Lord of the Rings and Harry Potter and all this stuff. It's something that they longed for. It was a wish, right? But they didn't necessarily know why. And then, as I went a little bit further in my inquiries with these things, it gets even more peculiar. Because as much as every single person I asked said, yes, there's a place for myth in the modern world. They also acknowledged, sometimes tacitly, sometimes kind of, you know, in the back, that myth is not necessarily about anything that is real or true or meaningful. They actually ended up disparaging myths. And you can see it in the way that we talk about the idea of myths. Myths as false stories. Foolish investments in a belief in what's untrue. Think about Mythbusters, right? Remember that show Mythbusters? I don't know if that's still on anymore, but that show Mythbusters. Or you can look in a lot of national newspapers and websites and so forth, and they'll have five myths about whatever, X. And all these myths are things that are untrue. Now, in all these cases, we have this interesting idea that myth stands as something that's counter to the real, counter to the world that we live in. And yet, there's a place for it, and people long for it. What is this thing called myth? What is it? What is this strange, bedeviling thing? Well, this is not an easy question, because its structure and its significance extends far beyond the scope of what we are ordinarily aware of. In fact, most of the myths that shape our thinking, that shape our ambitions, that shape our endeavors, and that shape our moral and spiritual horizons are only partially or half available to our conscious minds. There's a way in which mythology is always at work, percolating within the subconscious, almost finding a sort of metabolism within the deep aspects of how we think, and yet we don't seem to have aspects or access to it. So how are we to deal with it? It's this thing that's essential to us, that's a part of us, that breathes through us, and yet what and how and where shall we place it in which we think about it? And where should we place it today, here and now, how we live in this modern world that we're in? Well, like I said, myth is a tricky thing. But there are some things, as a philosopher, I think I can begin to say about it. This isn't meant to be exclusive, and it's not meant to be something that is exhaustive at all. But it can begin to point to some of the aspects of what a myth is. So, first, a myth, if nothing else, is a narrative accounting of sorts. We have a narrative accounting right here, straight out of Harry Potter. But it's a narrative accounting of the world that orients and attunes our consciousness to the environment that it's in, and it does it on its own terms. It does it on its own terms. Now, here's what I mean. Here's why we're showing this a little bit. A narrative is not a report. A report simply observes something empirically, presents the information as clearly as it can, and then that information is transmitted, and that's it. But that's not what narratives do. That's not why we listen to storytellers. That's not why we read novels. That's not why we listen to poetry. That's not why we long ago sat around the fire and listened to the shaman and the elders give these stories. That's not why we do these things. When we did those things, there was a way that the narrative, not the report, the narrative, the using of words and stories to tell something, brought our minds to a place where we were able, through the power of that consciousness, to entertain and bring about whole new ways of being. We could move through space, through time. We could be this way, that way, one and the other, and this made sense. It was through narratives that we had the same kind of oneric power, you know that word, oneric, dreamlike, as in to be in a dream, that oneric power of mind within the capacities of the waking moment, so that we could begin to move and imagine things that are impossible, that are far away, that couldn't be, that never were, that won't ever be. And yet, those things made sense, and not only did they make sense, they found a way in which we could begin to orient ourselves towards that environment. 10,000 years ago, the myths would make us better hunters, or gatherers, or parents. They would help us understand what death was, what birth was, why it is that the seasons changed. And it wasn't a question of being right or wrong or any of these other things. It was a matter of being able to take consciousness through this thing called narrative and move it around, fix it. Now this is something called phenomenology. Phenomenology is kind of a technical word. We use it in philosophy and a few other disciplines. But basically, it's a study of the structures of consciousness itself. Phenomenology is a study of structures of consciousness itself. You might say, oh, well, Seth, that sounds like psychology. Well, slightly different. The difference is is that with phenomenology, you approach the structures of consciousness from within consciousness, so from the subjective. In other words, if you are sitting and you are, say, bored, hopefully you're not bored, but let's say you're bored, and time seems to be passing very slowly. One of the things you do, you might do, if you were to approach it phenomenologically, is look at this experience of boredom as a subject, but try objectively, to understand what that is. You bracket it, and you observe it happening in your own mind, the slowness of time passing, or the quickness of it when you're excited, the way in which a moment passes on and on and on, and you go back to it if it's really significant, or a way in which you forget things very easily. Whatever the case might be, when you look at the structures of your own consciousness, this is phenomenology. The subjective structures of your own consciousness objectively. Phenomenology. And I bring up this bit about phenomenology because the narrative character of mythology is a phenomenological device. It's a phenomenological device. It is a way of using language and story to look at the structure of our own consciousness as it proceeds. This is one thing we can say. A second thing to say about myths is that they move through symbols. They move through symbols. Yeah? Yeah. Does that work better? Good. Okay. The hearing was up. I was wondering about it. Okay. Thank you, Julie. So, yeah, they move through symbols. They move through symbols. And this, to some extent, is rather obvious, obviously, that that myths are deeply and powerfully symbolic, that the things that occur within a myth, that move within a myth, are symbols that are some way trying to find some expression. But I do want to make something clear. While they are symbolic, they are not merely symbolic. A myth is not merely a collection of symbols. They are also stories that are embedded in this, with the symbols. So the stories and the symbols mix together in a particular way, in the way that we live, in the way that we tell, in the way that we talk, in the way that we work. And from that, they're able to tap into and approach these larger, longer ideas. And I would make a distinction here between symbols and legends, or symbols, myths and legends, excuse me. There is a way in which it's easy to conflate these things, and they often do get conflated quite a bit in ordinary life. I've heard and read a lot of different ways in which you can break this down, but generally it's something like this. A legend is taken as a tale that has at least the possibility of verisimilitude. That is to say, it has the possibility of having some aspect of truth. So, Odysseus lands on an island with his men, and he's captured by a cyclops. Now, there aren't any cyclops. It's probably not going to happen. It's unlikely. But it is possible, right? This is more legendary. But when you begin to get to these deeper aspects, when you begin to get to things that have to do with, on the first day, there was darkness, and there were the waters, and there was the spirit over the waters, and the waters, and there was the division between day and night, and the spirit said, let there be light, and there was light, and there was the first day. That's myth. And the reason why that's myth, as opposed to just legend, is because that's not something that actually lends itself to any sort of empirical possibility. It's something that lifts us, its power comes from, it lifts beyond the empirical. It goes beyond that to a kind of total cosmic being, a way in which we encounter the world in a kind of fullness that we wouldn't be able to do otherwise. And in this sense, brings me to the third point, that myths are the embodied rhythms of our being. The embodied rhythms of our being. This is By talking about myths as embodied rhythms of our being, it's a way of saying that as we go through the world and as we live in the world, we do it, as you probably observed, in an embodied state. We have flesh. We experience time, space, the aesthetic sense of the world. We do all these things. We have organs. And we move and think through these things. This is what it is to be human, right? Well, a myth takes the way in which this embodied encounter moves through the world, right? And it takes the rhythms of this and narrates it. It narrates the idea of moving and struggling beyond what's possible to struggle, facing the idea of the death of the body and the life, of love, of desire, of loss, of moving. It takes these and organizes them in a narrative. It puts them together in an almost objectified way that we can relate to because we, as embodied beings, can take this in some way and move it forward. In this way, it's a very human thing. You know, there's a famous quote by the philosopher Ludwig Wittgenstein in talking about the philosophy of language, and one of the things he says is that if the lion could speak, would we even be capable of understanding him? And what he means by that is that a lion is embodied in a different way than a human being. A lion has lionness. And you can say it about, say, a bat, you know, a bat. Bat probably encounters a world where sonar is a pretty important thing, and it's a big part of the bat's life. We wouldn't know what a bat's life is like. We wouldn't know what a lion's life is like. But we know what a human's life is like. We know what it's like to be like this. We can hear stories about people who have lived hundreds of years ago, thousands of years ago, in times that we didn't even know. And we can still go back through that narrative in that time and participate in that and feel that rhythm and know something of what it is to be from that myth. That's another thing that myths do. That is why myths bring a kind of human vitality in their being. Another thing, myths live, they move, they change with the dynamics of the people who tell them, even as they proceed with these rhythms. And I want to say this because it's important to recognize that as much as myths can take us to lives and places and ways of being that were long, long ago and far away. They things that we never could have encountered because they bring us through this narrative to this state of embodiment in this place and this way of being that we weren't at before. Even though they do that, it would be wrong to call them eternal. And I think that that's important. Myths are not eternal. They are not timeless. And they're not timeless because we're not timeless. We exist and encounter the world in and through time. They are, I would say, perennial. They are things that proceed again and again and again. They have this persistence to them. They have a deep rhythm to them. The way a strong rhythm in the river out there continues, or a strong current in the river out there, continues to go through and drive through and bring out all these different things. But this is one of the things that happens with it. Another theme that I would bring up with this, something I find that is misunderstood, myths, in tapping into these rhythms, are not then true. Myths are not about truth. And one of the great misunderstandings, I think, of the modern era, one of the reasons why it's possible to ask the question that we asked for this talk, is that there's a misunderstanding that myths somehow have to do with being true. Myths are not true, and they are not untrue. Rather, myths bear truth. They bear truth. Or maybe I should say they bear truths. They carry them. They embody them. They manifest them. They make it possible for us to encounter things in a deep and meaningful way, right? There is, I guess, one last thing I would want, or actually a couple things I'd like to bring up with this. A couple more things. Myth is, in this way, a way of thinking about and considering reality in a totalistic way. That we are not able to consider otherwise. What do I mean by that? Well, in our ordinary experience with the world, in this body, in this time, in this way, we see things, we hear things, we taste things, we touch things, we smell things. We have one moment at a time. We do these different things. But the way that we encounter the world is fundamentally from a point of view, right? It's looking at things this way. And one of the things that a myth allows us to do, again, by virtue of the power of its narrative, by virtue of the power to bear truths without having to be true, is that it lets us look and consider the world in terms of a totality. Now, when I say that, I don't mean, so you know how many grains of sand are on every beach in the earth. I don't mean that kind of totality. That actually would just be a very detailed point of view, really. I mean a different way of thinking. I mean in the sense that you can consider things in terms of their overview, that you can consider things in terms of totalness. And the advantage of that, the great power of a myth being able to do that, is that it centers us in the world. It centers us in the world. It puts us in a place where we are grounded and we can consider and orient everything. All of a sudden, the world that we are in is a world that every star has a place and we can navigate through them. This is what myths do. They mark our place. They mark our way. They mark the possibility for us doing these things. And one more thing I would say about myths as a remark, that mythology was explicitly the main way that human beings organized and oriented themselves prior to modernity, to modern life. So, mythology is a big thing, and mythology has had this hard time running up and into modernity, the modern world, modern life. Wow. Well, what's this thing called modern life then that we're talking about? What is modernity? Well, this is kind of a tricky thing. It's something I'm almost surprised by how people misunderstand this a little bit. But consider this. You know, we often think of the word modern as meaning contemporary, right? Just right now. But that's not technically correct. And one of the ways I could show you that it's not technically correct is that if you look through the vast history of human civilizations, at least as far as written history goes, most of the time, people didn't talk about modern times, even when they were talking about current events. They didn't say, in this modern era of 24 or 33 BC, you know, I mean, no one did that. It was something that only came about in a real specific situation. It actually first began to appear in the 13th, 14th century in Europe. And the word modern was telling, because the word modern is derived from the Latin word modo, meaning today. So modernism is todayism. Todayism. Well, what is this? What's so special about this todayism that started out in Western Europe and seemed to expand out to the rest of the world? Well, essentially what it was that this todayism, modernism, saw itself as trying to look at the world as you would understand it and as you would evaluate it right here, right now, as an individual, right? So there's no... The sources of authority that had marked and colored and shaped so much of human history, human existence, really, up to that point are pushed away in modernism. The authority of rituals, the significance of symbols, of traditions, of intuitions, and yes, of myths, are all pushed aside with the rise of modern consciousness. And in their place, put in their place, are virtues that are verified and reified, that lift up today and are a way of evaluating and working that don't need any of those things, that don't rely on rituals or traditions or myths, but they work with today. What are those things? Well, we actually, they're things that we almost take for granted now, but are really distinctive features of the modern. Things like autonomy, self-rule, you know, the idea that the individual is in charge of him or herself, right? That they are in possession of this, that they have their individuality, that they have their rationality, that they do what they must do and they proceed accordingly. And that they are rulers, lawmakers unto themselves by virtue of this. That comes out of a modern mindset. The lifting up of empiricism. The idea that you would begin to evaluate things and understand things, measure things, consider things in terms of observing them and testing and retesting and retesting by virtue of these observations. This isn't to say that people didn't do this before. You know, you read someone like Aristotle or some of the Nyaya philosophers, the Sheshika philosophers in India, or lots of different people. It's not as though empiricism didn't exist at all, but the authority that is given to it. The idea of saying, I'm not going to listen to anybody else. I'm testing this for myself, and I'm going to develop methods for testing it. That's modern. That is modo. That is today-ism. And it's something that people didn't really do with this kind of authority until just a few hundred years ago. Rationalism. Lifting up the power of reason. Yeah, and, of course, reason has been respected for, you know, millennia, probably eons. People appreciate reasonable arguments, reasonable positions. But rationalism itself, the idea that reason itself had this kind of extraordinary power to transform and change and pierce into things, this also is a feature of the modern. And lastly, systems. The idea that you would organize thought, that you would organize society, that you would even organize yourself through systematic organizations. All of these features of this todayism, right? So this is what we have. And good things come from this. I don't want to dismiss the modern and the way in which it's undercut so much of traditional society and the power of traditional society from this. Think of what we have. I mean, there's certain ideas, certain virtues that we lift up that actually are very, very good in many, many ways that are a direct result of modernism. Liberty, the idea of liberty, individual liberty, that we ought to be free to choose of and for ourselves what we would have, that's a modern idea. It's part of the reason why America, probably the great experiment in modernism, it lifts up liberty as one of its cornerstone ideas. Progress, another idea that comes out of modernism, that every way we're getting better and better, moving further and further ahead. Technology and science and scientific achievements, these are obvious examples of this. All of these are good things, they're extraordinary things. They're what make it possible for me to have this device that I seem to hold too close to my mouth once in a while. They're extraordinary things, right? They have a lot of power to be able to do this. But unfortunately, modernity makes things very hard on myths and mythological thinking. This is where a lot of the disparaging remarks that I was talking about at the beginning of this come from. Here's some of the ways that modern life is so tough on mythology. For one thing, It dismisses the power of mythology to be able to help us organize and orient ourselves, our beliefs, our state of being in the world. Here's what I mean. There's a way that when you, I imagine that most people in this room would, while you might find certain myths comforting or interesting, you don't go to them easily or quickly, at least not very often. And yet, think about what myths do. Myths help us when we are in the midst of despair. Myths help us when we're lonely, when we feel lost, when we don't have any sense of who we are or what we are or what we would hope for or where we would go. When we need to figure out why something is the way it is and the place that it belongs in our thinking. These sorts of things. Myths give us a way of centering and organizing. And it's what we've done for eons. It's the way that human beings have made sense out of this. Is it any wonder that in modern societies you seem to have spikes in things like alienation, depression, mental illnesses, anxieties? Is it any wonder? You've taken away the central thing that human beings have used for millennia to help themselves with that. You know? It's a basic feature of what we are. We need this. We need a place for myths. Another thing that myths do, and another thing that the dismissal of myths has made hard. Myths help us correct our thinking when we get stuck in some mode, some pattern of thinking. Here's what I mean. There are ways, particularly in modern life, and particularly by virtue of the methods and things that we have available to us, where we can really begin to pursue and think through and work through ideas with rigor and analysis, with this empiricism, with this rationalism. We can be very, very effective in it. And yet, there are stories upon stories of tragedies that happen when people fail by virtue of the way they succeed. I was just listening this morning, actually, to a rebroadcast of Fresh Air by Terry Gross. And she was interviewing, actually it wasn't Terry Gross, it was the other guy, Dave Davies, who was interviewing a woman who, she's a reporter, but she's a science reporter. And she was talking about the problem with epidemics, plagues, a lot of the dangers around big outbreaks and contagions that can happen right now. And one of the things that she brought up with this was she was talking about antibiotics and the way that antibiotics are losing their effectiveness. And part of the reason they're losing their effectiveness at a much greater rate than they would otherwise, she said, was that drug companies are overselling antibiotics because there's a market to sell to people even when there's not a medical need for this stuff. So that there's mutations and the viruses begin to mutate and adapt to the antibiotics. This is something that wouldn't necessarily happen as fast if the drug companies were more careful about the way in which they distributed this stuff. But they're not. Why not? Well, they gotta make a buck. Because this is part of what they do. This is their reason for being. They are a business. They proceed these ways. This is a big part of what they do. I would say that they're following one particular myth, modern myth, as a matter of fact, rather blindly. But other myths, other stories, other things that tell us about the perils of something like this, they could begin to change this. They could begin to bring a little bit of wisdom to something like this. They could begin to get you to say, maybe I need to think in broader, longer terms And that brings me to a third thing that myths can do and that it's become much harder to do in modern life. Myths make it, when we take them seriously, make it possible to take long-term thinking and do long-term thinking for long-term crises. Think about some of the greatest crises that face us today. They're crises often that we're not immediately aware of. They're things like climate change. They're things like the threat of nuclear war, right? Things that drift, some of them have drifted off in the back. We don't necessarily pay a lot of attention to them. We know about them in particular ways, but they are there. And they could radically alter us, destroy us. They can do all of these different things. How are we supposed to deal with this? Are you just supposed to go and tell people, look, be rational. Don't do these things. Don't act this way. Well, we've seen that doesn't work very easily. We have accords, we have meetings, we try to do things to solve these problems. Rationality alone won't save us. Or more specifically, the methods of the modern won't necessarily save us. But there are things that can save us. The wisdom of our elders can save us. The stories that we know that have these rhythms, these narratives that show us the way in which things rise and fall over hundreds and thousands of years, that move our minds beyond ordinary space and time, that lift us in our imagination to these places, that can help us. That can make something real to us in a way that we wouldn't be able to have real otherwise. Myths put us in a position. They position us, phenomenologically, to go back to this word, in a way where we can begin to address huge issues that we couldn't understand otherwise. If you think about it, it makes a lot of sense why, before modernity, mythology was such an important problem-solving tool. It's because it made it possible to be able to lift oneself out of what you couldn't see and still consider things deeply. And there was a lot that couldn't be seen. So myths were a very, very valuable tool. And there's one more thing I would bring up with this too. In addition to the way in which it helps us deal with our myths would help us deal with ourselves and our own psychological states and emotional states, and in addition to getting us out of our own boxes of thinking, and in addition to giving us a way to look at this totality, myths have helped us recognize things to such a degree that they slip into our thinking even when we're not conscious of it. I would say that this thing I've been talking about, modernism, is itself a myth. That is to say that there is a modern world, that there is a modern point of view, and that the things that go along with it, oh, well, there's progress, and there's science, and there's democracy, and there's capitalism, and there's these other things that proceed in these ways. This is a myth. Now, or actually it's a series of myths. This isn't to say, and I want to make sure this is really clear, this isn't to say or disparage those things. It's not to say that that these things are untrue. This is not saying that, oh, well, if I say science has this mythological character to it, that science is untrue. That's not what I'm saying at all, obviously. What I'm saying is that something like the scientific method gets treated mythologically in modern consciousness, and we do so unconsciously. Let me show you a little what I mean by that. If you think about what science is really a method. It's a method of observation and analysis, right? And it's something that's based on a principle of fallibility. Philosophy of science classes and a scientist, you never prove things are false. You never prove anything is 100% absolute true. That's why it works as well as it does. That's what makes it work, is that you never prove anything is absolutely true. You prove things are false. And yet, think about the way in which someone will invoke the name, but it was proven scientifically. How do they invoke it? They invoke it like a god. They invoke it like something that is infallible. Ironically, a system based on fallibility, and they invoke it as though it's infallible. This, to me, suggests that one of the things that we do, that we have, it's the source of a lot of what this longing is a deep, probably instinctual drive towards the mythical. I think this is a deep feature of human consciousness. It is part of the way that we think about the world. And it is absolutely and necessarily integral to it. So, if I'm saying this, am I saying that we should abandon the modern world, that it's brought myth down and we need to bring myth back to its former glory and power from pre-modern times? Is that what I'm saying? No. No, it is not. Not at all. Actually, I think modern life has a lot to add to the mythological. But we need to acknowledge and appreciate it for what it is. What can myths do in the modern world, and what can the modern world do for myths? Well, keep in mind, myths change, grow, they live, they die, they move. They're not static, and they're not eternal. They move with the rhythms and energy of us. And modern insights can help us have a clearer appreciation of these dynamics. They can help us have a clearer sense of what they are. Think of anthropology. Think of linguistics. Think of what these things have done to help us have access to whole hosts of mythological experience, mythological ideas, mythological truths. Truths that are born through mythology, right? This comes from the modern. We have an enormous amount that's available to us that we wouldn't have had otherwise. And even more than that, consider this. You know, the way I've been talking about this, I've talked about myths in rather grandiose terms, but it's important to realize myths can succeed or fail. It is not as though every myth is equal or everything a myth is a good thing. Myths can flounder. They can collapse. Consider the myth of the superiority of the Aryan race, right? An artificial myth, admittedly, but a vile one, and a destructive one, and a pernicious one. But it was a myth. It tapped into these deep visions, and that's part of the reason it had the power that it did, right? There are ways with modern life, with modern achievements, with modern methods, with modern systems, with modern institutions, where we can look at myths and we can cleave them away. We can clear them. We can get to a place where myths can actually be removed of the debris that prevents them from being everything they can. You can critique a myth, but you have to be able to understand it for what it is, just like you have to be able to understand modernity for what it is. And so, if we can do this, if we can appreciate the modern for what it is, and all of its achievements, and we can appreciate the mythical for what it is, and the place that it has in human consciousness, and the role that it has for our understanding, and the way that it bears wisdom, and you can get these two things to work together to augment one another through observation of the modern, through the vision and inspiration of the myth, That's excellent question. Isn't it?
Society
is that you use the instruments, particularly the analytical instruments of modern life, to be able to look into this. You know, there, when you see things like this, this bastardization of myth, this exploitation of it, you can also use things like satire, like irony, like sociological and anthropological analysis, like political measurements. You can use all these things to say, look at this, here's what gives here. You can be honest with these things, and you can get deeper. It's not as though it's hopeless. It is, it's, there's a way in which you're always fighting a certain battle, I guess, trying to get through these things, but it's not endless. It's, the struggle continues. The locker continues. Others.
You mentioned in our mythology class that myths are something that emerge out of the conversations and dynamics between people that, you know, use the myths and tell the myths. And I'm wondering if the way that we sort of get past and get beyond and transform from the, you know, myths of modern life, I'm wondering if the way that we do that is through, you know, community, as a community, from the different people that make up that community.
I think that we absolutely do it through community. I think that one of the things that, that mythology allows for is it allows for us to experience the deep and the sublime and the powerful as a community. There's a reason why probably one of the few places where myths can explicitly still find expression in modern life is in a place reserved for community, namely the church, right? And, it, and it's reserved for it. It's carved out for it that way. It's a space, a sacred space that is carved for participation and celebration of myths. Sometimes, unfortunately, even the myths aren't recognized as myths. They're taken as something else, and you end up with fundamentalism and kind of perniciousness. But when that doesn't happen, when the space is reserved for myths and celebrated myths, it's something that people go to on a regular basis and need, because it allows them to organize and orchestrate themselves the way this power of mythological thinking has done, again, for eons, and people do it in that community. So, one more question.
Sorry to wrap my language around this. Can you do a comparison between, like, that was the Ada Pigman symbol, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Compare Native American mythology with Greek mythology. The obvious seems to be it's nature-based animals, mm-hmm, versus the Greeks using people, basically, with, mm-hmm, superhuman powers. Is it just a difference at the point in history or evolution of that society?
I think, well, this is part of what I was trying to get at with the whole idea of the rhythms of our embodied being. When I was talking about that, what I mean is that there's ways that, I mean, human beings are such extraordinary creatures, because we have this way that we're in this body and we're encountering this world, and yet unlike, say, a snake or a jellyfish or a butterfly or some microbe or something, we are able to go forward and we begin to navigate and narrate and think in all of these different ways about the world. We find this new way of going. I think that when you have different narrative traditions, sometimes radically different narrative traditions, that are tapping into mythologies, lifting up values and so forth, that that's an expression, it's almost an emanation in a way, of the rhythms of the power of this vitality and living, and finding a way to make sense and pass that on. And that's sort of how that works. You know, there's a, you see, for instance, within a lot of Chinese mythology, you see a heavy, heavy emphasis on dynamic relations, on transformation, on relationships. In African myths, especially West African myths, you see an emphasis on animism within animals, and the idea that the animals manifest and work these ideas forward. In, you know, in Norse mythology, and a lot of Northern European mythology, you see a lot on struggle and on journey, right, and on Thank you.